Welcome to Starfleet Boy, where we have a casual and informal discussion about our beloved series, Star Trek.
I'm recording, and I'm also going to record the Skype. The Skype that rhymes with hype.
I can't
see. The hype
see.
Skype.
I couldn't see
the
you
hype
anymore.
Skype.
Are we doing just video, maybe? Just audio, maybe?
No, we're doing video and audio.
Okay. Fair enough.
I don't know how to make... You don't see me at all now? Because I can see you eating.
Yes.
Which this won't air. This won't be on the aired version. Don't worry. I wouldn't do that to you.
I mean, I gotta eat, so you can.
Let's see what settings while we wait for you to finish chewing. How are you, by the way?
I'm good.
Good.
I'm good. I saw Joker, and I very much enjoyed it.
What did you enjoy?
Joker.
Oh. I'm afraid to go see it.
Really?
Yeah, I get really, like, really sensitive to scary shit. Like, things that feel like they could happen in real life, like, freak the
I think, okay, my mother's kind of the same. She can go see, like, any kind of ghost story. She doesn't give a shit. But if it's about, like, a serial killer, or, I think, Interview with the Vampire freaked her out.
Oh, but see, I love it. Figured out how to make myself big. Go on, sorry.
Excuse me? No, the movie is, in a sense, I mean, hyper-realistic. Yeah, you got the Picard on.
Sorry, I wasn't trying to distract you from talking about the Joker.
No, I mean, usually comic book stories involve, for example, Joker falling into, like, a vat of acid, and then he becomes the Joker, but that's, like, if you fall into acid, you die, right?
Yes.
So this movie...
Generally, unless you're, you know, unless you're the Joker.
Well, this movie doesn't do that. This movie really concentrates on trying to create a character from reality. I think that's what scares people.
Wow.
It's not a scary movie. It's not something that you're... It's more how it impacts you following it, you know? Have you seen Brightburn?
No. Oh, no. Is that the one that's like the kid that has powers similar to Superman?
Yeah, that's it.
No, I haven't seen that yet.
So that's not so much a scary movie as it is... It's all about... I don't know, it's thematically, it just freaks you out. And so Sarah's been, oh, well, look at that. What is that?
It's the blur the background feature.
Well,
it's too much, right?
Do I have that?
Yeah, try it.
Where's my...
Click on your screen. You gotta right-click on your screen, on your video.
Yeah.
And then just click on blur the background.
It doesn't say that. It doesn't say it for me.
Oh, you're not as advanced as
I am. Yes, I have. There we go. Look at that.
Ah, there.
Oh, my goodness.
I wish you could change the background, because we could have, like...
The stars.
The bridge. No, the bridge. The show takes place on the bridge.
Well, I would be in space.
I'm going to unblur my background. It's freaky. It's too distracting.
Does it blur my food?
Yeah, a little bit. It's so weird what it does. This is for our audience that partakes in psychedelics or psychotropic.
This is a Patreon exclusive, but you don't have Patreon.
No, but you do, and I'm so excited! I can't wait to subscribe. Even though I haven't seen an update since you sent me the preview, and now I feel left out because
I released the video.
I thought I was going to be your first Patreon, but
I released two people the video.
Beat me to, two people beat me to it. I was so mad. I was like, no, no. The line must be drawn here. But I am going to subscribe. I am going to subscribe.
I'm honored.
To your, to your channel.
I'm going to unblur this.
Even if there are... Thanks. Even if there are no levels or, like, gifts, I'm okay with that. Because I get the best gift of anyone. I get you on my show, which is...
That's right, you get me.
I get you. So.
I can come on and bitch about short tricks with you.
Yes. I'm not bitching, but yes, we're going to bitch about it today. Sean might bitch about it. I think I have a few bitches. There's a couple of bitches I have. But they're always the same ones. My bitches are always the same.
Your quarrels, your beefs.
My beefs, my bitches, my beefs. All right, so I'm gonna start for. Oh no, you're still eating. You have two. How many of those do you have? Do you have how many burgers do you have?
No, just two. Am I not allowed to eat during the actual show?
You can. I mean, Humbert does it, so we could do that. If you're not embarrassed, I'm not embarrassed.
I'm fine. It's half a hamburger that I have to finish. It's fine. I think it's
all right.
It's all right.
Clap for, well, but eat, don't not eat. Okay, so here we go. Clap for continuity. 1, 2, 3, clap. 1, 2, 3, clap. Beautifully done, my friend. And we're back on another exciting episode of Starfleet Boy, where we have a casual and informal conversation about Star Trek. Star Trek Short Treks is what we're focused on today. And we're going to split it in two. You're cool with that, right?
I don't care.
We can just keep recording, though, because I can split I can do afterwards.
Whatever, I'll do whatever the hell you want. Boom, light. Let there be light, sir.
Well done.
I do whatever you want. I can do this in two. I can do this in one.
Let's just see how this goes.
We could recap season two of Discovery at the same time if you want. I mean, I don't...
we could just combine everything. All right, so Q&A is the episode we're talking about primarily, but we might, as we just established, talk about other things.
So I'd like Sean's to say...
Yeah?
That I officially designate this as season two, episode one of the Short Treks, but it would seem that on the posters that... like CBS is releasing, it's just episode 5 and then episode 6, which is, so I'm like, okay, is this, I feel like they have no seasons, they're just releasing Short Treks as they come and then whatever.
Yeah, and they're, because like, you could either say they're micro seasons too, because there's such a space apart from them, so each show could be a new thing. I am happy with it just being episode 5, that's awesome.
I am too. I frankly don't care. I just like the concept of just having this kind of random.
When you take over content as the showrunner of Short Treks, you can start a whole new season so that everyone knows. All right, this is the
this is it.
Trek on the Tube era of Short Treks. That'll be interesting.
This is the coherent era of Short Treks.
Wow. You don't make it easy for yourself to get that coffee boy job at CBS.
I don't. I really don't. Hey, look, I stand by my my thoughts and my values, right? I stand by what I...
No, I love it. That's why you should be the show nerder. So since you're eating your wonderfully homemade halal burger, I'm going to give the summary of the episode. And also, before I start the summary, I just want to put on the record, Sean, that when I do come to Montreal, I would really love it if I could have a homemade... If Mrs. on the Tube would be so inclined, I would love to have a homemade halal burger.
I'm sure we
as
can
well.
Make that work.
Excellent. That sounds quite delicious. So it's Spock's first day on the Enterprise.
That's the recap. It's done.
It's true. I mean, you're actually right.
It's Spock in number one. They talk.
This Short Treks travels back in time to whatever. Do we know? Is there like an official year that, as far is the canon cop around?
Year one.
What does that even mean?
I don't know. Look, Spock. I'm gonna type in Spock in Memory Alpha, and the article's gonna be like 15 pages long. I couldn't tell you. Truly, I don't know. I don't know.
Did we get a star date in the episode? I don't know if I paid attention well.
Arrival
enough.
On
there
the Enterprise.
Was.
Oh, here we go. When Ensign Spock was transported aboard the Enterprise in 2254.
Okay, so
he bonded with the ship's first officer, Lieutenant Commander Una.
Are you giving the summary from Memory Alpha?
Who preferred to be known simply as Number One. Later that year, Spock would be promoted to Lieutenant, and we see him as Lieutenant in the cage.
Isn't it Lieutenant? Like
Lieutenant?
Yeah, like in New Zealand, wouldn't they say Lieutenant instead of Lieutenant? Like just
well, it's got a U, doesn't have a F.
No, but you still say Lieutenant.
Do you?
I think so. Ask.
Well, everyone in Star Trek they say Lieutenant, don't they?
Yeah, no one says LTE. Or is it just LT? It's LT. LT.
What confuses me is sometimes when they're Lieutenant Commander, they'll say Lieutenant, but sometimes they'll say Commander. I'm like, where do you go with that?
But he's an ensign anyways.
Well, in this episode. Yes. Thank you for fixing that. So that is correct. Carry on.
So later when he's a lieutenant commander, that's why they say that. I don't know.
He's an ensign.
Maybe they say he's an ensign. He's an ensign Spock. So yeah, ensign Spock comes aboard the Enterprise. You said the summary already. You expanded on it. And then he has a moment where he bursts out into song. He's inspired to burst out into song and laugh. And then he's kind of shamed for it a little bit and told to forget the whole incident, and then he proceeds to a station and meets Captain Pike for the first time, and I was just like gushing with all the feels of the feels, and just like, wow, this is like Spock's first interaction with Captain Pike. It's here, it's documented on super high quality HD that pierces your eyes out. It's so good. It's the quality's so good. Anyways, I just like was so happy and chuffed and pleased and charmed by that. And I'm not hiding my opinion, obviously, of this episode. And that's it. Bob's your uncle. The episode is over, and we get the credits.
There you go.
That was the whole episode. What did you think of it? Like, what was? Did you like it? Did you not like it? Did you have beef? Is this a bitch fest coming? Are we ready?
This is it. This is my beef episode. Okay. It seems to be tradition to start off every season of Short Treks with a crap episode. Hey, you wanted the
beef.
But
that would mean there's only one. There's no seasons, first of all. So you're fucking wrong. Hey.
Every package, grouping, every bundle.
Good grief.
No, I didn't like Runaway. That was the first episode of the first batch. And I'm not a fan of this one. I prefer this one to Runaway, if I'm honest. I really do.
Oh, well, that's good. A little short treks rank.
I mean, yeah, no, it would be average on the low side. It, you know, in my trusty
we used
scale
your here. We used it on your on Drunk Space Line. Oh, last really? Night. We Did didn't you? Even. Yeah, I didn't even make a mistake last time. I like forgot, and then I used the regular rating system, and then I, you know, but this time it was like, wait, there's
I
a
have
rating
the system.
I have the system, and I found it, and we used it last night. So average on the low side, really. Yeah. So that would be like a 4.
It'd probably be like a 4, yeah. Because technically, my rating scale is like it's out of 11, so it goes from 0. There's like a clear 0 to a clear 10.
Oh, I thought it went to 11.
No,
because true greatness is like
no, because
to me,
average is bang on 5, right? And then you work.
I'm always skewing it towards the. I'm always skewing it towards the higher rating. Well,
I
skewed it towards
the higher.
If I
made a rating system out of 5, you would consider it 3, 3.5, 4, 4.5, and 5. That's you can't go lower than 3. You're gonna love it. Yeah, no, I understand what they were trying to do. I really do, and I like the idea of. Everyone knows that I'm not the biggest fan of Spock, and that I'm kind of tired of seeing him. But I understand the appeal.
You're Spock fatigued. You're fatigued.
I'm Spock fatigued, but I've been Spock fatigued since friggin', you know, TNG. So,
wow. That's hardcore. I don't remember you being. Yeah, I kind of do actually. Now that it's all coming back to me now. I'm like, oh,
flashes.
Yeah, it hits you. He was the. Everyone's like, oh my gosh, I'm Ambassador Spock, and you were like, fucking shite. What is this bullshite? I don't know why I said shite, but then the F word I said normal. It should just be fucking now. Or fracking.
It's fucking. It's fucking
shite.
It's fucking, isn't it?
It's fucking shite.
Fucking
shite.
Anyway.
Fucking shite.
I have Spock fatigue, and I've had Spock fatigue for a very long time. The Kelvin timeline didn't really help with that, because it gave us two Spocks at once. And now we're getting, you know, young Spock, little Spock.
He's actually like, not little Spock, because that guy's been on Discovery, but this is like, you know.
Yeah, little Spock's the Discovery one. He's also been in the Kelvin timeline and the anime series.
If you were to take like a Vulcan lifespan into account, like what is Sarek's age when he dies? He's like close to 200 years old, if I'm not mistaken.
I think he's
right?
older than that. I think he's like 234 or something.
So if Sarek is an indicator of like an average Vulcan lifespan, then Spock is actually like, you're right. He is actually,
he died 203.
Oh, 203. Well, okay. Considering that, like, You can say that if he's in his 30s, he's actually more like he's 15.
Yeah, I mean, you can interpret it that way.
Like, Spock is a teenager.
I don't think it works that way. I think that...
Why? Why not? It's physiology.
I think it works differently. I think when they're 15, or like, you can still consider that they're 15, just like us. It's just that once they get to like 120... they start accumulating more knowledge, and they get better. Like, they have more levels to unlock than us. It's pay to win, basically.
I see what you're saying. But anyways, and physiologically, he does not look like a... Physiologically, he doesn't look like a 15-year-old human would, so I see what you're saying also. Mm. But I'm just saying, like, in Vulcan time... he's still very young. He still has very little experience. So one can compare that to how a 15-year-old would be, you know, experimenting with who you are, like trying to figure out your personality, like figuring out how to, you know, like fit into society. And I do think that this episode kind of like gives you a glimpse of that quality. And you know, for me, that's Ethan Peck's performance. He's a great performer. I love Ethan Peck. So,
well,
as a performer,
yeah. I enjoy it. Yeah. I enjoy the idea of Spock pre-Cage. I enjoy him being, you know, pre-post-Cage, like around the Cage era. I enjoy him being more emotional, because we saw him in the original Cage episode. He had the smiles and what have you.
Well, and even in there's an episode in TOS, I forget what happens, where Captain Kirk, he thought he was dead, and he comes back and he like turns around and he grabs him and realizes, oh crap, I'm like, I got excited, you know, like he's like, and he, you know, so Spock has
human side, and
he's half human. I mean, just we can't forget
in touch with
we can't
it,
forget
in
that
sense.
Yeah, but not only that, physiologically he's a combination of human and Vulcan. Mm. So, you know, many people say that a lot of our emotional response is related to our chemistry, like, you know, the way our chemicals are made up in our body, whether that's through ingestion or just like what your body creates naturally, right? And so your emotions can be influenced heavily by your body chemistry. So imagine what it's like to be half Vulcan. Like, you have like the wackiest body chemistry going on.
But what you gotta keep in mind is, like, it's not like he's got an emotion human side and an emotionless Vulcan side. That's not true. He has two very emotional sides, because Vulcans are very emotional. It's just that, right, Vulcans learn to suppress those emotions
or control them, I think,
or control them, right?
Right, yeah.
So it's not as if he has like this cold self fighting against this bubbly self.
In the original series, it kind of portrays it that way a little bit. Like, he is kind
of
like at least the humans, at least when the humans interact with him, like, they, you know, like Bones calls him like cold-blooded, green-blooded hobgoblin, and compares him to these like very like monstrous cold things. And of course,
so racist.
That's how you would be. You would be the same way. You hate Spock. So you would be the worst to him. You'd be like, could you just leave me alone? I'm fatigued by you. I'm fatigued by you. I
would
don't
you
need
take
you.
Take your pointiness somewhere else, man.
I already know you're in all the Star Trek.
I need not.
Just leave me alone.
Your analysis.
Leave me alone. You don't have to be in my Star Trek, okay? Get out of my Star Trek.
Get out of my Trek.
Get out of my Trek.
This is mine.
That's your
line must be drawn here.
That's how you that's how you would treat poor Spock, who's trying to figure himself out. That's his encounter with you. But of course we know you'll become dear friends with him just like Bones does.
Of course.
And he'll give you his Katra as a gift. I would give you my Katra, by the way, if I were in danger and I needed to pass my Katra to someone. I would totally pass it to you. You could hold my Katra for a little while.
I feel like if we could, we would have already passed each other's Katras, just in case, right?
Yeah, just in case. Katra just updates every month. You get a
I mean, you get smacked by a car. Well, he's got my Katra. I'm fine.
Yeah, I'm fine. It's pretty cool. They just repair my body and then take me to Mount Celea and let the magic of the Vulcan priestess work its way to bring me back to life. I mean, it's a simple process.
why is it not done?
But going back to Q&A, you know, there isn't much to say about this episode. I mean, everything we've been talking about, I guess, is ancillary discussion, but it is just a simple little vignette, and I think I took it for that. And within that, I think I found it to be quite perfect. I was very charmed, as I said earlier, and pleased, and cheesed, and chuffed. And in a way, no, we don't have a Star Trek Pike show, and it's going to be clear that they're going to probably set the Pike show at a different era than this, so it's nice to get this little prequel, right? Like,
I would
way,
enjoy a Pike show pre-Spock. I know this might be controversial, but I would like a Pike show pre-Uno, so pre-Number One and pre-Spock. I would enjoy that.
What was he doing? What does history say that
exactly,
Pike was doing?
Exactly. We all know that Pike captained the Enterprise, and Pike captaining the Enterprise would be the same thing as Kirk captaining the Enterprise.
Not really.
Well,
he's got a different style.
It's the same era. It's the same ship, and it's like, I mean,
Kirk comes across so different to me. Like, at least William Shatner's Kirk versus Anson Mount's Christopher Pike. Like, I think to me, Pike is more like this, like a genuine cowboy.
I wish that we were in a time where we could do a crossover event, like kind of how they did the Deep Space Nine in original series. We could do a Discovery original series, and so you have, like, Pike interact with Shatner.
That would be amazing.
Anson Mount interact with William Shatner. Like, have those two captains kind of...
I think what we can hope for, I would like to see William Shatner himself back in Star Trek, and so in Doctor Who,
he's
there's
dead,
a
Matt.
Great... No, what?
He's dead. Not
William Shatner,
but Kirk.
Yes, but I'm just saying I would like to see William Shatner in Star Trek playing another character or a mysterious character, and he's not really dead, by the way. Captain Kirk comes out of the Nexus several times in the Apocrypha. Do you know what? There's the canon and then there's the Apocrypha. I'm all about taking information
from the
Apocrypha.
You're all about the nonsense.
Yes, I am. Starfleet Boy is all about the nonsense. The shenanigans. But anyways, it would be neat to get William Shatner to reprise his role as Captain Kirk. In Doctor Who, I know you don't watch Doctor Who, there's a famous actor who is beloved named Tom Baker who played the Doctor. He was the fourth actor to play Doctor Who. And in the 11th era, the 11th actor who portrays Doctor Who, because different, you know how it works, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. In the 11th era, the fourth Doctor actor made a cameo as a character called the Curator, and it was just like he curated a museum, but there was like enough mystery that you were like, wait a second, this could actually be somehow the fourth Doctor interacting with the 11th Doctor. So
like
that's
time
how
travel
fans,
shenanigans or whatever.
Yeah, all kinds of things. Yeah, when in Doctor Who, it's so easy because it's all about time travel.
Well, I think.
But if the Kelvin Kirk makes it to old age, that would be a neat thing if he can actually jump across into the whatever you call it. I hate the prime timeline. You're so blurry, by the way, right now. I don't know what's going on with your camera. You're like super blurry.
I got that
it's
blur.
Very interesting. It looks like the Witness Protection Program.
Are you going to modify my voice?
But if the Chris Pine Pike, Chris Pine Kirk.
The Pine.
The Pine. If the Pine ages all the way to older age, then you could conceivably have a real Kirk that is there, you know? And so the Kelvin Kirk can come to the prime time. It can be done. There's all kinds of imaginative ways to bring William Shatner back as Captain Kirk. And I would love to see that. Short Treks, even.
I would like to bring back actors, but not as themselves, like not as the characters that they originally portrayed.
Yeah,
give them like what? Give Prince? Them like another species, or maybe just another character. If William Shatner doesn't want to do all like the facial makeup or whatever, that's fine. Just he can be another human, right? Or
I'm happy with that too.
Slap on some black eyes, and he's Bajoran.
It'd be nice Bajoran, to even
Betazoid.
It'd be nice to even see like Nichelle Nichols make an appearance, and if she's gonna play another character, she could play like old Mother Burnham even. I'd be happy with that, you know, any way to get these performers that are still around, because I just love them, you know. And I think that's the thing about Star Trek, is you get such great talent attracted to it, especially nowadays. Like, I mean, Anson Mount's insanely great as an actor.
Who openly enjoys Star Trek and has openly said that he wants to be a part of Star Trek multiple times is Tom Hanks. And I like.
Yeah. Oh my God! Why isn't that a thing?
I don't know. The guy says multiple times in different interviews, "I love Star Trek. I would like to be in Star Trek." No one's ever called me. I was like, first of all, you're Tom Hanks, so you call them, and they'll hire you on the spot. Second, why is no one like jumping on that?
That's crazy.
He would be an amazing like Romulan commander or something.
No, I think Tom Hanks deserves the next captaincy of the USS Enterprise. Like, if we do a Star Trek show on board
no,
a ship...
No, I would give it to his son, Colin Hanks, because he's younger.
No, 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 no,
no,
no, no! You're wrong! Why would you diss Tom Hanks like that, bro? You're such a disser today.
I'm not a disser. I love Tom Hanks.
You dissed Spock, and now you're dissing Tom Hanks. You're such a disser.
I love Tom Hanks.
Tom Hanks should be the next captain of the Enterprise. Damn it, that would be an amazing role for him. Or an older Captain Harriman, if he likes that era, and he wants to portray Captain Harriman late. We don't know what happens to the Enterprise B as far as canon is concerned, right?
Yeah, I think that's a very blurry moment in time, and a lot of people want to see that explored.
Right, so that could be a great way.
Give
also,
us the Hanks.
I wouldn't mind if he played a previous Captain of the Enterprise, but he has to play a Captain of the Enterprise.
Do you think he could be Robert April?
I think he could actually be Robert April. That would be an honor that I would think.
That would be amazing. Tom Hanks is Robert April? Because you could only do, like, maybe just the Short Treks. Tom Hanks isn't going to come in for a Short Treks. He's like, nah.
Why are we getting so hype about this Tom Hanks thing?
Well, because the Q&A had nothing hype about it.
It's not even
so
real.
We need to talk about
something
else.
It's not even real. It's not even real. It's fake news.
Okay, here's my quarrel with Q&A, all right?
All right,
because in essence, it's not actively bad. It's just that I found the directing to be a little awkward. There's a lot of shaky cam. It's not, you know, very clear in the beginning. And I don't understand what they were trying to show us exactly, apart from the fact that this is Spock's first day. I mean, they're trying to show us that Spock is already, he's more in touch with his human side or his emotions. But we already get that in season 2 of Discovery. And then they try to show us that Una is very intelligent and, you know, strong-willed. But she can also kind of relax if she needs to. But we've already seen that in Discovery Season 2 as well. So this episode brings us nothing.
Well, I think what it
brings
us is...
And then the only thing left is basically the aesthetic of the Enterprise, which I disagree with, personally. And the inside of the turbo
no,
lift, which, again, I disagree with.
Wait, and we also got this open space Willy Wonka space elevator.
Yeah, I mean,
I know.
So I'm left with not much to enjoy. Also, I think the dialogue that's like the everything that goes on between them isn't very interesting. They're not saying anything of great interest.
There's no way to reconcile at this point the look of the Discovery era with the rest of Star Trek. It's just already, it's like You can't reconcile it. It's just, you have to really, I wrote a tweet about this. You have to really stretch your imagination. But you know what? For me, the feeling I got from this episode is, and I think this might have something, I'm going to use a line from the episode where she describes Captain Pike as being unsentimental. I think that's you. You're unsentimental about everything except horses.
It's, I think it's the very contrary. I think I'm very sentimental. And I think that the people creating Star Trek don't understand this. Because often, so I will say that I don't like this new bridge or whatever, and like the words gatekeeping and what have you get thrown around, it's not true. I think that people need to understand that if I'm unhappy, it's because I hold the original Enterprise dear to me, and this genuinely makes me sad. Alright?
I'm sorry, I don't mean to laugh, but you shouldn't be sad. It's not like the end of the world.
It genuinely does. I know it's not the end of the world, but some people are happy with this new Enterprise. It makes them actually joyful. It makes me actually sad. And I feel like people dismiss that opinion so easily. Like, if you disagree with anything Discovery does, you're on the other side of the fence and fuck you, right?
No.
But that's not fair.
No, that's not how it is. That's not how it really is. Come on, Sean. It's not, your friends don't do that to you.
The community does. The Trekkie community does at this point. They can't, it's like you gotta love Discovery or you don't. And if you don't, then you're a hater and you have to, you know, just go check out your Doomcocks and what have you. It's like, I don't want to do that.
You know what, Captain?
I'm a fan of Star Trek and I want it to be bitter.
You know what Captain Pike would say to you, Sean, right now? Do you know what he would say? In his unsentimental way.
I like horses.
He would say that too, but he would say Trek on the, because you know you're not Sean you're Trek on the tube. Listen, you can't choose who's a fan of Star Trek, but you can choose your friends.
Fair enough.
That's what he would say, right? So just surround yourself with friends. Don't forget about the haters. Just haters gonna hate. That's what they do. And the players gonna play. I just want to shake. Oh my God. Shake it off. I do know that you get a lot more interaction because of the sheer volume of people that tune into your content. And I know that it can weigh on you. And I just hope that, like, I hope that you can realize that, like, you can have a dissenting opinion. I hope I don't make you feel bad when I laugh
absolutely.
You know, like, you can have a dissenting opinion. It doesn't affect, like, my view of you as a person. And I actually also think your opinion is totally valid. Like, I can see the other side of the argument. And I'm actually there with you in many respects as well. But to me, I guess just to me, like, overall, I've accepted that this is going to be different and that I can't do anything about that. Like,
well, I have
and
I too. Can either, it's just that...
Right. But then when I did that, I'm just enjoying it now. And I think that there's a lot of hard work put into the stories. And I do think they, like, try really hard, and we'll talk about this in Tribbles, they try really hard to, like, kind of fit into the established storyline, but then do something else. And if Star Trek, the original series, never existed, I have to say that everything looks so fucking good in these new Star Trek iterations. The production value, like, despite how much I disagree with it, like, it's Star Trek like I've never seen it ever before.
I agree. Like, and so, that makes me so even more, like, you know, sad. Because the production value they have is through the roof. They have, like, so the budget is insane. And also, they have so many talented artists. They've got so many talented designers, so many talented, like, creators, and all of these makeup artists, and everything that they're doing is just top quality, right? But they're doing it, excuse me for saying this, but wrong, essentially. They're doing it their own way with their own twist, and that's not something that I agree on. I mean, I don't know.
I
understand the
objective
of updating an original series design. Like, Enterprise updated the original series Andorians, they gave them a more, but they didn't biologically change them or physiologically change them. They didn't add things or remove things. They just made them look better. Whereas Discovery just outright changed shit and they don't care.
I was angry like you are now when Enterprise came out. Like, every point that you kind of just made about Discovery,
but you were,
like,
wrong.
I,
Because Enterprise,
you might be
Enterprise,
wrong too.
No, yeah. Enterprise was 100 years before the original series,
which is why it should have looked like The Expanse, like in my mind, like it should have looked totally different than what it looks like. It didn't fit.
No, because The Expanse is basically now. It's basically 20 years from now, whereas Enterprise is in like 2150. This is 100
right,
years after now.
Right, but it still should have looked closer to The Expanse than to what it was. It looked too... They were just not right. They were just not right in my mind. And, like, I just thought, like, that... For a time, that was, like... I actually stopped watching the show. I couldn't take it. I was, like, so upset by it.
The difference here is they literally like, took the same ship as in the original series. They tell you it's the same one, but it's not.
It's not, and they're not saying anything. No one's saying anything like super. I think like in the show, there's no explanation at all. It's just done. Right.
So this is how it is.
That's the other thing is that I just kind of look in. I just kind of ignore what all the chatter is about. Like, you know, I think CBS at some point, I have a strong feeling there will be an official statement that says this is a reimagined universe. And like, thanks for enjoying it with us. Here's another show now set in like, you know, the universe that you really love and enjoy. So I think that's okay. Star Trek, I mean, they're even calling it the Star Trek universe. We've already had a Kelvin timeline. We can have a Discovery timeline. I'm happy with that. Like, I actually don't care how they explain it at this point because I'm enjoying the stories. The stories are really, really good, in my opinion.
Well, in my opinion, they're
worth,
not.
It's worth it. Yes, we know. And what I think that this episode... well, I think your rating's going to drop lower than what you...
No, because we're talking about Discovery specifically here, whereas this, like, this Short Treks in itself, it brings nothing much, but it's not, like, it's not outright bad, it's just kind of, it is what it is, right?
What was your, we've heard a lot about your gripes with this episode, what was the thing that you liked the most about this episode?
Oh, God. I got no clue. What did I like the most? I don't know. That's the thing. This episode brings nothing to me. There's nothing.
You're so conflicted. Like a minute ago, you just said, "Well, it's not that bad," and now you're like, "I can't find."
Well, that's
any
the
value.
Thing. It's not that. It's not that bad. But then it's not that good either, is it? It just exists.
I think if we were to set aside the looks, my favorite part of the episode was when the three of them are together on the bridge at the end. I like the way that the very first, what would have been the very first interaction between Pike
and Spock. How is that useful
to
see? We've already seen that.
It's just pure sentiment. It's just pure sentiment. It's like,
it's weird that you react that way. Okay, it's...
I do.
I find it strange that this... that you react this way because you've already had that moment and that sentiment at the end of season two. You get what I'm saying? They've already done that.
That was him coming back to the bridge after a long hiatus.
But that worked for me. And that worked for you the same. Spock, actual Spock with no beard and his uniform and his science-looking face, walks onto the bridge and we get a Spock number one Pike moment on the USS Enterprise bridge. And that brings something. And you're like, ooh, I like this. And then these, you know, warp into space. So doing it again is useless.
But it's different because it's his genuine first time on the bridge of the Enterprise. Spock in the Enterprise, Spock is on the Enterprise till, you know, they decommission her. So he spends like, you know, his whole career basically on the Enterprise. I don't know how long he had been serving as an ensign on a starbase or whatever he did before, but the Enterprise is his baby. All of them, these guys, you know. They're all gonna be coming on, and so to see his first time on the Enterprise is like it's delightful. Like I don't know how else to describe it. Like
that she says, like he's not getting on the turbo lift originally, and then she says, "Hey, do you want to see the bridge?" And so he does get on the turbo lift, and then when he gets to the bridge, he just takes his post as if he was supposed to go to the bridge in the first place. But originally,
well,
what she was doing, she was giving him a tour of the ship, and because he had answered or asked valid questions, she thought, "Hey, I might as well show him the bridge." But they kind of they have two different narratives. They forget about the first story that they're doing, and then they do a second one.
his when he first arrives, maybe he was going to go to his quarters and check in. I mean, like, we don't know where he was actually planning to go, but he ends up on the bridge after whatever medical exams they have to perform and whatever he had to do before. So, like, Una comes back earlier. So the original, whatever the original bridge tour thing was going to be, it got stopped by the elevator. So it fits fine for me. Like, I didn't see a
incongruity. None of what you're saying, the medical thing happened. It's literally,
no, that was like me saying, like, something else was happening after they got out of the space elevator. I don't call them turbo lifts because that's not what they are. They're space elevators. But anyways, I do agree with that point.
Well, but, nothing happened. They went out of the... Oh, I see what you mean. Okay, they got, like, something they got happened rescued. Between that,
they got rescued, yeah. And then something had to happen after that. Usually it's a medical exam, right? Like, they have to make sure you're... She got electrocuted.
Okay, so they went to sick bay, and then they went to the bridge.
You didn't like this episode, so you weren't paying attention, but I was, damn it. No, I'm just kidding.
I don't know. It was a bit bland. Like, it was just kind of useless.
But if you're giving it, like, a four, I mean, you have to have loved something. Like, something had to have been, like, lovely. Just one thing if you gave it a four, right? Like, otherwise, you should really give it a zero. Or one. Based on, like, the conversation, I'm not hearing your fours.
No, because... You know,
there's got to be one thing that you like.
It's the episode is Spock and Number One having a conversation. Right?
Right. While stuck in an elevator.
That's it. That's it. There are things that I don't like, which are like the aesthetics.
It's an exposition. It's an expository, is that the word?
Yeah, but I mean, I can't you can't go around and say, "Oh, I don't like that." They don't say anything, like, they're not, you know, it's not a commercial. It's not as if they were trying to sell me a product.
We learn what... there's a lot of little details that we learn. We learn what kind of operating system runs on the Enterprise. We learn that the food processors work off the Una formula, which is a combination of two other formulas. We don't find out if Number One likes eggplants, but we...
Is that a sex joke?
I don't think so.
I hope not, because I don't want Star Trek to be run by children.
I mean, I think it would have been a sex joke if the eggplant emoji appeared.
Okay, here's what gives us the four. All right, you want the four?
I'm gonna try to make the eggplant emoji appear when you said that over the screen. I think I have the ability to do special effects, but go ahead. Sorry.
You want the four? I think the visual effects are good. I think that it was beautifully lit in the elevator. And I think that all the performances are very respectable.
I
think that all of the actors do a very great job. It's just that the material that they're given is just basic. But I think, yeah, no, they act well. And yeah, it's beautifully lit. The CG is great.
The production
quality
sure.
is good.
Yeah, oh yeah. I mean, it's phenomenal. It's insane. Like, we watch it in HD on the big screen TV as a family. My mother and I. My sister doesn't watch the new Star Treks, and neither does my dad. But he'll tune in
that
if
says
he happens
a lot.
To be in the room. Well, no, I don't know. I don't think it says a lot. I think my sister's never been as big a Star Trek fan as I am. And my dad, while he is a Star Trek fan, it is too much for him. He can't, like, all the beauty is too much for him. He's like, I can't, you know, like,
I don't want to put my mother on the spot here, but for all the people that think that, like, Discovery is fantastic and what have you, she's not aware of the online chatter, right? She doesn't know what's going on online or the beefs or whatever. She has basically two comments about Discovery. She says it doesn't look like Star Trek, and she says the women on the show are too much. They piss me off. So it's Discovery is a
what is that? Can
Discovery
we have
is
your
a
mom?
Feminist modern show, and she doesn't like both aspects of it.
Can we have your mom on to find out
to.
More about her
I would
feelings?
Love to,
that would be pretty cool. Mom on the tube.
Mom
that
on the tube.
Awesome.
Anyway, I don't want to, like, put her on the spot here, but those are her sentiments.
Since you brought your mom in,
but
since
she,
you brought
she,
the heavy
thing is,
I'll tell you what my mom says.
Okay.
She can't get enough of Anson Mount. She's obsessed with him. She thinks he's the hottest man she's ever seen on the planet. And she's like always, when are we going to watch the show with Captain Pike? And I'm like, Mom, there's not a show with Captain Pike.
You want
Pike.
The highlight? You want the yes. highlight?
Oh my God, what's that?
Wife on the Tube made one comment about Q&A. It was about Anson Mount's ass.
What? Wow, Wife on the Tube. That's why you're so pissed. Oh, now I understand why you're so pissed.
I don't. I would prefer to watch 10 minutes of Anson Mount's ass than Spock and number one.
That's
speaking.
That's the next short tracks. It's just focused on Captain Pike's ass different, and it follows it angles. Everywhere.
Oh, that would be amazing. He goes from engineering to the bridge, just follows ass.
There you go. Children just wrote a short treks.
We did.
A short treks as children.
This is a very puerile thing. I love it. I approve.
All right, cool. I love your justification for your four. I found that the... on the technical level, the only complaint, since you did the four things that you kind of did four things that you liked about it, I'll do some of the things that I disliked about the episode to kind of even us out. But I don't know if I cared for the extended shots of like the badge and like, you know, the in the beginning when he's going to transport up to the Enterprise, there's like these weird shots of his ear. And it's just like they're beautifully, I mean, the lighting and like the way it's composed and everything, I have to give like a million kudos to. It's gorgeous stuff, but it's like that doesn't feel like Star Trek to me. Like they don't really show off. There's never been a thing where you like have like a shot like, and it seems like we're always looking at the badge. It's like, we're always looking at the badge. We're always being reminded that this is Star Trek, and I think that that would make it a stronger show if we didn't have all these like constant reminders of the you know the emblems, right? So that part kind of bothered me a little bit. The Starbase kind of didn't look like what I imagined Starbase 40, I think it was, or whatever it was, like, would be. Like, I imagine I would have liked to have seen Ensign Spock, like, walking through, like, the mess hall or something, and it's this beautiful CG, big, gigantic set. I think that couldn't... I think if we spent less money on the shiny badge and more money on the environment, it would have looked a little pretty. That was not fair, I know. That was a jab. But anyways, that would be like my biggest kind of like qualm was just kind of those kinds of
so you,
things.
So you're talking about the place where Spock is before he beams aboard the Enterprise. That weird kind of corridor with a bunch of lights.
Corridor,
in it.
Transporter.
I don't understand what that is and where it's supposed to be. That's supposed to be some sort of Starbase thing. It makes no sense. That's why they filmed. But I mean, they could have just begun it on the transporter room with him beaming on.
Yeah, they that was actually to me. You probably forgot that scene because that's where the episode kind of could have just started. You're right, and it would have been just fine if they had started that.
Because we didn't need like a close up on his ears. What are they trying to show off the makeup? Because they just got like.
And then there's like a Dutch tilt, and they close in on his face as he's transporting away, and he gives a hint of a smile. And again, great, but you could have done that from a wider shot and like just have a like. I think Star Trek
before he transports, and when he appears, he continues like he basically finishes his smile. And that's why Una like she says, "Oh, I noticed that you smile. Like, don't think I didn't see that." But I think he tries to. I think he smiles as he beams. But the idea was to show us that he stops his smile as he comes aboard the Enterprise. I don't understand. You're going to have to explain this to me. I like the fact that Una says she doesn't want to hold him back or hold anyone back on the crew. Like, you be yourself. But then she says something about, but don't do this because you want a command position. So don't smile or whatever.
I think what's funny about that scene is that like, you know, Spock doesn't finish his career with Una. We don't even know after the cage. Like as far as we know, he doesn't stay in touch with Una or any of the members of the crew. As far as we know, there could have been a tragic accident and Una's actually dead and he just holds her in his memories. Like, you know, we have dead people in our lives that we don't talk about with our coworkers, you know, and friends.
Well,
Burnham. Right. So,
I mean,
well, she's not dead. She's not dead. She's in the future.
No, she's not dead. But what I mean is like, she's someone that was very important to her.
Yeah. He holds her close to his chest. Right. Exactly. But I think what's ironic about the scene is that Una actually got it wrong. He doesn't as far as I know, Spock never actually commands a starship for any length of time. Like, no. He actually retires. He retires with the rank of captain, but as far as I know, he never captained a ship. He just kept serving.
He's just basically an ambassador often.
Right, and he was a trainer. He trained cadets. Like, that's how we find him in Star Trek II. In Star Trek The Motion Picture, he'd actually left Starfleet and was pursuing the Kolinar. So Spock is... What the journey ahead for Spock is legitimately what he says here. He says, I'm not interested in a command position. And she's like, bullshit, Spock. So she read him wrong. It's ironic.
Well, you're wrong. Know
what I mean? Well, you're wrong. I'll prove you wrong, bitch.
Have you not seen the 50 years of Star Trek?
Yeah, have you not seen it?
Come on.
But I thought that was the value of the scene, is that there was a bit of irony there. And it was interesting to see it kind of like come to life in that way. The two actors, it was just like a charm. Again, I'm charmed, chuffed, and delighted by this episode because of all these in things.
We've talked about it for like a good hour.
We have. We should stop, right? You want me to give my rating?
Go, give your rating.
This episode gets a 9.5.
God damn it, boy.
God damn it, boy.
All right, well, I guess I give it a 4.
Excellent.
So we can even that out now.
Hey, Siri. What's the average of 9.5 and 4?
The average of 9.5 and 4 is 6.75.
It's a 6.75. It made it over the line. The line was drawn and it made it over. It survived.
What do you mean it survived? What, can it just
below
die?
A 5. Below a 5 falls in the crap episode bin.
Oh no. Oh my goodness.
Right? Shit episode. Sorry, we say shit episode on Starfleet.
Shite. So no, shite is really low enough.
We'll end this episode by going, hey Siri, play Modern Major General. I can't even say it right.
Oh, no, please no.
I love that song, Gilbert and Sullivan. By the Pirates of Penzance. From the Pirates of Penzance.
My God. Why is this a thing? Why do the people in the United States enjoy this song?
I am the very model of a modern major general of information, vegetable, and animal and mineral life. I can't do it that fast. Anyways. Oh, this is a good performance. You can just see Data singing this. Yeah, I can see Data singing this. Hey Siri, stop. Okay, so we did it. I don't know how long I can make those things go on, because you know what? YouTube flags all that stuff.
Yeah,
the AI is YouTubes. Magical. It's
the YouTubes get mad. Like, hey.
The artificial intelligence got mad at me. So I was like, oh, whoa. Please stay friendly. I don't want to be annihilated when the world ends. But we're going to stop this recording, and then technically we're saying goodbye. Goodbye, everybody.
See ya.
We'll see you next time. We're not actually going to stop anything. Let's just keep recording, or do you need a break?
I'm fine. Let's just dive into it.
Boop, boo. Boop, boo. That was a fun discussion.
It was.
We found our way back to friendship at the end. We did. It was getting... You were getting really hot. You actually pointed at me at one point.
I did?
You really... You're wrong. I thought you were going to throw your keyboard at the screen.
How dare you?
God dare you.
You know what? I gave it the same ranking, and I feel about it the same way as I feel about Calypso in the first one, which is an episode that many people enjoyed. So, I mean, I feel like that not only the Trekkie community is consistent, they enjoyed Calypso and they enjoyed Q&A, but I am too. I didn't. So I feel like it's all right. Everything works out.
I genuinely think you're the reason why, because you're not Doomcock, thank God.
No.
But I think that you do give very real, harsh, sometimes opinions, but in a way that stays true to your love of Star Trek. And so I do think that like you might have something to do with the way that Star Trek is going to be shaped in the future.
It's very nice of you to say something like that. I wouldn't think so.
And you and the millions like you, because there's a lot of people that have beef. I had beef when I started. I flipped the switch one day in my head. I had to figure out a way to rationalize what I was enjoying versus what I was hating. And I know it's annoying, but That's what happened.
I'll tell you what, there's been a flip that's been made, because I feel like at one point, when all of TV was kind of average, Star Trek was spearheading that. It was just the best. It was beautifully written. The sets were good. Like, everything, it was just all just amazing, right? But now it's flipped. Now all of TV has become so excellent that Star Trek is trying to play catch up. It's just not there yet. It has so many years to catch up and so little time. So I feel like all of these mishaps and these missteps that we're going through with Discovery and the Short Treks and what have you, this is all making up for lost time. If Star Trek had carried on throughout the era, because this big renaissance of TV shows that have happened, you know, between 2000 and 2010, like the Breaking Bad era, basically. If Star Trek had kept on going through that, I think it would be really strong right now. But I feel like it's got to catch up to that. This may be just like a completely bullshit analysis or whatever. No, but
I think you are right that TV is so much better today. On even show like Netflix puts out these little short series, like 8 episodes. Like sometimes they never go more than one season, but like every now and then there's like a jewel. And you're like, wow, like this is like a show that would not have ever made it, you know, before.
Just something
look
like
at
The
how
Boys.
Provocative or interesting. Yeah, yeah, that's a great
and
example
like,
of
Netflix
of like
puts
that,
out they put out Dark Crystal.
Yeah.
Age of Resistance, right? That kind of stuff never could have existed back in the day, and it's all of it is beautiful.
I think when you set a show, any show, that has so much like Whenever you do prequels, it's problematic.
Absolutely.
And I think that, like, if I were the people running Star Trek, if I had the money to do this, I think that both Enterprise and this show as prequels are a good experiment. But as far as I'm concerned, what's really interesting to me is coming up, which is, like, Discovery Season 3. That's, you know, yeah, Discovery's past is not ideal for what I would have liked. But, hey, Discovery Season 3 is genuinely has the opportunity to be, like, a new interesting Star Trek show, I think. And, you know, there's already like glimpses of things that are already kind of interesting. And then Star Trek Picard is just a gift in my opinion. It's like, I don't care like too much about, you know, I'm like a little worried about like the look of it, because I think those special effects are not final. Like in this Short Treks that we're about to talk about in the Tribbles, that ship, the research ship, it's gorgeously rendered. Like, it's so beautiful. Yeah. And the Enterprise, that opening shot when it comes in, whether it's wrong or not, it's just a fucking beautiful, beautiful shot, right? Like, so we'll just go right into our discussion now.
We will.
So welcome back, friends, to another exciting episode of Starfleet Point, where we have a casual and informal conversation about Star Trek. Today we're talking about Short Treks Episode 6, The Trouble with Edward. The Trouble with Bob.
Or Season 2, Episode 2.
We just established there's
however
no
you want to put it.
Grouping. I thought grouping was the...
Group 2, Episode
group
2.
Group 2, Episode 2.
Bundle 2.
Bundle. I like Bundle better than Group.
Like Bundle?
Bundle, yeah.
Or is
it
Batch?
Just sounds so...
I think it's Batch, isn't it?
Batch.
It's a Batch.
You're
of
a Batch.
Tricks. I'm a Batch.
You're a Batch.
How dare you, sir?
This is the Trek on the Tube batch of Starfleet.
I'm still recording the same audio, by the way. I didn't hit, like, I'm not recording a new audio file.
That's great. It's not
okay,
a problem.
But that's great.
We're also doing the video never stopped.
Oh, nothing stops. It all continues.
Well, I thought it was just easier, right? Like, cause,
no, it's fine.
I mean, unless you needed, like, a bathroom break. You get to do the summary of this one.
Okay.
As Bob. No, I'm just kidding.
I do the summary of this one?
Yes, sir.
Alright,
I nominate you. Wow, you're actually accepting.
I can do it. You give me the complicated summary out of the two, don't you?
I had the easiest summary, I have to admit. Right,
so,
it's true, it's very easy.
Newly promoted officer.
But you got that halal burger, I'm sorry. I still remember that, and I don't forgive you for eating in front of me and making my mouth water with envy.
What is she called? What is she called? The captain.
Oh, the captain, hang on. I will tell you right now because I can pull this up on IMDb. We're so unorganized today because I recorded
anyway,
an episode
so she's
of Drunk
been
Space
recently
Nine last night.
Promoted to captain. She just recently became a captain. and she's on the Enterprise. She was a good officer of Pike's, and now she's off to captain her own ship, a science vessel. And she has
trouble with
Edward.
Edward, the captain, played by
She's famous. She's someone.
Oh, here she go. Played by Rosa Salazar, and it's Captain Lynn Lucero.
Okay. Lucero, maybe?
He says Lucero, I think. Captain Pike says Lucero. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so...
She was a scientist. She's a captain that became... She's a captain of a research vessel, and she's a... Like, she's in a... Like, Janeway. Janeway was... Wasn't she, like, an engineer or some... Janeway's, like, specialty?
I don't know.
Janeway's
a boss.
We forget that the captains had a specialty at one point. Like, you know...
Yeah, no,
like,
absolutely. They can come from any department.
That's kind of cool. Any department, it's kind of cool.
But you have to do some sort of command training or whatever.
Right, of course, but
you can come up from any department. Anyone has a shot at the captain's chair.
You can... By the way, command training also doesn't have to lead to command, because I think in Q&A, or somewhere along the lines...
Acceptance and to become a captain...
To be a captain, Spock had to go through command training, right? Just like Savick is going through in the beginning of that movie, you know, the one that you don't like. Twok. Twok.
Twok.
By the way, you should already like this episode more, because there's no Spock in it. And
I would
Spock
like to say officially that I do like The Wrath of Khan.
I know.
I find it overrated. That's it. Much like Q&A.
I love your shirt. I'm going to interrupt your summary. I'm so sorry. But I love your shirts that you made, and I plan to buy one soon. I don't know if I'm going to buy the Halloween one. I don't know if that's my jam. But if you make a shirt that says, I find it underrated, I will totally buy that shirt. I would totally love
I'll get my trusty Gary on that as soon as possible. Then.
I find it overrated would be like my favorite shirt. I would wear it everywhere, I swear to you. That would be the best shirt. And it has to have the Trek on the Tube logo, of course, and some cool artwork. But I would definitely wear that.
Is this a catchphrase of mine? Is this something that I often say?
I don't know if you say it often, but it was brilliant the way you just said it right now, and I would like a shirt to memorialize that moment. It just gave me so much joy.
Okay, so essentially,
it's not that I don't like you as a person. I just find you overrated. Go on,
Newly promoted Captain Lucero, ex-officer of Pike's, embarks on her beautiful journey as captain of whatever science vessel that she's been given. And she has a mission...
The Cabot. The USS Cabot.
Okay. The USS Cabbage. And,
Cabot. Oh, well, Cabbage. We could call it that.
No, she has basically a mission, very important, near the Klingon border. Where she has to help out this planet, which is, I think, like, this planet, they're all starving to death or something, so they need to find a new food source or something for this planet.
That's, like, a reoccurring theme in all the Tribble episodes, because in the Trouble of Tribbles, it's Sherman's planet, I think it's called, or something like that. We'll call it Sean's planet. But it's actually called that. It's, like, the name of a person, apostrophe S, planet.
Okay.
It's like, do you remember? Do you remember it all?
Not. I don't remember the details of it.
And in the, I just saw them, so I'm like super fresh. and then the animated series episode, I think it's called More Tribbles. They're heading to that same planet with the same kind of grain, and they don't really explain why, but it's a weird thing. And then it's like if it takes place like 3 weeks later, but it doesn't. So I'm not sure what's going on in that episode. It's kind of weird. But I liked it because I liked the little monster that you showed off earlier offline.
The glommer.
And we're not sure if it's its mouth or its rectum, but it's down there.
These are his eyes, by the way.
Yep. There was a cool guy when I went to the Florida Supercon. There was a guy dressed as a giant tribble, and on top was a glommer sitting on top of his costume.
That's fun.
Yeah, and it was very cool, and his name, his name on Instagram is It's Tribble Time. And we we're friends now, so go check out It's Tribble Time. Oh my god, you have a tribble too. Well, here's my tribble. You have more. Yours are multiplying fast.
I even have the pink tribble from the animated series.
That's brilliant. I only have this tribble. My tribble is it's been castrated. It can't reproduce.
Well, it was born pregnant, so.
No, remember? Oh, and you don't remember. In the animated series, Dr. McCoy figures out a way to inoculate tribbles so that they no longer reproduce. It's like a humane way of killing them.
But it would look like this. It would be pink.
Yes, that's correct. That's because they could only afford
so
one
your,
color.
So your tribble, the only explanation for your solo tribble is that it's dead.
You could also put that on the shirt. Your only explanation is that it's dead.
Oh my god. Yeah, all the Star Trek haters would buy that shirt.
I love it. Go on.
You can apply it to any context.
Yes,
you can. The trouble with Edward is about Edward, who has come up with this near flawless plan to bring this species of basically aliens here. He wants to bring them to this planet and have them become the principal food source, he says, but the problem is they don't reproduce fast enough. So he wants to inject them with human DNA, believe it or not, his own DNA, to have them reproduce more. So I don't know how injecting something with human DNA makes them pregnant at birth, but it did. He's a scientist, so he did the science, bitch. And it goes terribly wrong. It goes terribly wrong. The tribbles start, replicating wildly.
Exponentially.
There's also a moment where he gets basically fired from his job. The captain says, I don't want you on my ship, because he sent...
Well, because I'd love to talk about that, by the way.
Yeah, he had a very The Orville moment. Where he sent emails to Starfleet HQ saying the captain is dumb, anonymously, and then he dies because the captain basically doesn't want to save him. He gets submerged by a wave of tribbles, and that's
okay.
It. And then
wait a second, hold on. It took me a second to parse that. You said he dies because the captain doesn't want to save him. She keeps telling him, like, come Edward, you have to get on the
that's not your job as a captain pod. You have to go and grab him.
Who wants to grab Edward? He's like awful. He's like
oh worst. Really oh okay
no,
well, that's
I'm just
very
teasing
nice.
Teasing
that's
totally
very nice.
Teasing totally teasing
I love
no,
how
he was
in
too
TNG,
far away
when at first we meet Barclay, everyone was like, oh, he's awful, let's just kill him. Well, let him die. No, they
that's
help
what
him.
Happens. That's what happens in the TOS era, though. It's a different time.
Oh, it's
period.
A different time.
It's true. Remember, there are things that are, if you were to like be a strict canonist, is that a word? Canon cop, right? You kind of have to accept like the social implications that are presented in the original series as well, and you have to kind of believe Captain Pike was a bit misogynistic. Like, he's like, that's no place for a woman. I mean, he actually says something like that in The Cage. Like,
he says
that,
I still have to get used to having a female
oh,
first
that's
officer
what it
or something like
right.
that. A woman as a first officer.
Yeah, so it's safe to say that says a lot about, you know, the general views of society at the time, which, you know, it's a little suspect. Because we like to retcon some things about Star Trek, but not other things. And I think it's only fair that you, like, keep in the spirit of, you know, all the original series with its bads and its goods.
They never addressed that, by the way. They never addressed that comment. It would have been too delicate a situation. You couldn't really walk into that. Although, Enterprise, as hated as it is, addresses the Orion slave girl situation, and they make it so much awesome, like so much better. They turn it into like the most awesome thing.
Oh, that it's a plot. It's a plot.
It's a plot.
Ploy.
It's all a ploy. Yeah. it's all a deception.
Right.
Where
the
woman
it's actually
are actually
a matriarchy.
Orion's
a matriarchy, right? Yeah.
Are
yeah,
in control,
yeah. It's a matriarchal society.
It's awesome. I love that. Good job, people on Enterprise.
But see, you have, you know, on Earth we definitely have more of a you know, like a male-centric society. And that's something that's changing today. But in Star Trek's time when it was made, it was very different than it is today. So they were maybe... they were maybe ahead of their time, but their time was pretty bad. So, you know, it is it is what it is.
It is what it is.
It's all relative. But fortunately, there's enough value that Star Trek as a series can survive, I think.
The thing is, the Captain Pike comment doesn't have to be... because we take it as a general... we understand that it came from a time where... maybe that was the mindset, right? So we understand and that actually, it is a general comment, but you don't have to take it as such.
Right, you can and you take don't have to address it here either. Comment. Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
What but I mean is...
we don't have to address it... sorry. Sorry, I was skipping it. I was just saying that like the Pike we see in Discovery is a later Pike, so we don't even have to address that because he could have grown out of that mindset. And so could have... you know, mindsets go back and forth and they change and things... it's not all clean. It's very messy how society changes its mindset, right?
Here's like, the thing.
It's okay.
It might not be a mindset. It might be a personal comment about his experience. It might simply be
right.
that he's only had
yeah, I agree
male,
with that too.
Male first officers in his career. And so now he has a female and he has to get used to it. That could be the explanation. So he's not sexist. He's just, oh, every time I turn around, it's a woman now. And for all of my career, it's always been a man.
That's a great in-universe explanation. I think that that's the part that is the important part to focus on when you're looking at the story. But I think just like in general, when the writers wrote that, they were also writing and commenting on the state of like, you know, America basically at the time.
Of course.
So that's what I think it was.
All right, so the trouble with Edward.
Oh, yeah, good summary, by the way. Except for I disagree that the captain let him die. Although she does call him an idiot at the inquest at the end.
So I like this.
Your
one
summary doesn't
Jordan.
Have to include this, but we have to talk about the East. What do you call it? The post credits sequence.
Okay, that I don't understand. Okay,
but did you like it?
This is my thing. Not really. I didn't.
Oh, okay.
I didn't really like the post credit scene or whatever it was. My question is, and this is important. Is it canon or not? Because traditionally, what's been said is everything, like every TV show or movie that's ever like made and that's ever on our screens, that's canon. So all of those events are official and they have happened within the Star Trek universe. And even the short tricks. I feel like this little post-credit thingy is just a joke for the Star Trek community, and we don't have, like, we can't take this seriously because... I mean, it's so preposterous.
Well, because it's the very first post-credit sequence ever in Star Trek, which, by the way, we didn't talk about. because of that, I think, yeah, you're absolutely right. It can define its own precedence. Like, from now on, maybe post-credit sequences could be where you get the most absurd, crazy bullshit, you know, that
I wouldn't mind
want.
That. If they came out and officially said, look, these things don't count in the official story of Star Trek, but we're going to do them because they're fun. If they came out and did
that. I think it'll depend on what the next post-credit sequence we ever get. I mean, Short Treks is so unique. Like, all of the opening credits are unique. Like, I think that, in general, there's a whimsical quality to all the Short Treks. You know, they all have, like, they're a little more playful than the series, which is a lot more serious. So I think, in general, the Short Treks are just, like, more on that vibe. You know, like, the opening credits for the last episode was the... you know, the Q&A like stopped, broke, and sparks flew out of it, you know, kind of like indicating what
you know,
was
every title
this
sequence
one, like,
they, well every
yeah and he like yeah it replicates or whatever like a tribble does. So I think overall the tone is just so are the Short Treks canon. I think they present side stories.
The thing is Short Treks is officially technically a Star Trek TV show. No matter what its bizarre format is.
Right.
And so it is. I'm just
so far,
asking, just talking about this end credit scene, it feels like it's just a little joke that we can all enjoy as a Star Trek, like, it's kind of like a Galaxy Quest thing. It's not a Star Trek canon, but we can all enjoy it as the community.
It's obviously that way because we definitely don't see anyone eating tribbles ever again.
No, and it's so ridiculous. It's, and did you read the things that were written on screen? Like, you can choke and you have to kill them correctly when you eat them, because if you don't, then they can replicate inside your digestive tract. It's.
But those are all, like, it is non-canon, but if they did eat tribbles, that would be true. It's so gross. It was really gross. I couldn't. I almost barfed when. Yeah, it was like it's not appetizing at all. All right, good summary and good debate about the canonicity of the post credit, the very first ever post credit sequence in Star Trek. Did you know it was the very first ever post credit sequence in Star Trek?
Well, we've never seen one before, so yeah.
Well, yeah, because some of us I haven't seen everything. You've seen everything.
I think post-credit scenes are a pretty modern thing anyway. So up until basically the Kelvin timeline, for starters, we never would have got a post-credit scene in a movie. That's not a thing that people did.
Now I have to watch the credits of everything Star Trek.
There's nothing.
To know for. Are you sure this is the very first one? I think I was told this is the very first one. Are you consulting the Google?
Well, I just wanted to write post credit in Memory Alpha, see if they come up with something. No, they got nothing.
They got nothing. Maybe we broke the news. Do you think some people who don't watch credits like just don't even know this exists? Like, is that a possibility?
I think a lot of people missed it. But like, if you're on the Star Trek Twitter, then people know because they've been talking about it. But yeah.
On the drunk scale, even though it's not Drunk Space Line, what was this episode?
I think it's average on the high side.
Ooh.
I mean, it was fun. I have a few quarrels with it. I'm not necessarily a fan of the fact that humans are always involved with everything. Like, I don't feel it was necessary to make it that it's humans. We're such an arrogant species to make it all about us all the time. I don't feel like we needed to make the humans responsible for like the way that the tribbles replicate. It also makes it a bit bizarre now that Kirk and Spock and Bones are kind of completely unaware
about. So you would have liked. You would have liked Edward to be like an Andorian or a Trill or a Vulcan. Like,
I would have liked
that character
to be a completely alien species. For example, instead of having the Starfleet ship, just set it on the planet. Just cut Starfleet out of it completely. Cut the Federation out. Just
radical reconstruction of this episode.
Well,
you're
not
like
so much. Just do it the planet and have scientists on this alien planet, this alien world, people that we've never seen before. They have discovered this species and they're at a food shortage and they're trying to find a way to make this species kind of, you know what I mean, self-replicate or reproduce faster so that they can eat them. Because they're all going to die. And then so the episode focuses on that.
My impression
and then
was...
They get overrun.
My impression was that Edward, who's a specialist in, physiology, biology or whatever, was working on a side project. And when the captain came aboard, she was like, okay, that's an interesting project, but let's put it on hold. Because what's really working is all this, like, atmospheric changes and, like, you know, planting, you know, crops. And, like, I think we can actually, like, save these people in a different way. And he's just like, look, I have this, like, really easy way to make meat protein, you know, which is, like, gonna revolutionize, hunger for this planet. And she's like, but it's just gross. It's like, it's unethical and it's gross. So he's all miffed or whatever. So my impression was that, like, what's funny to me about this episode is it's the same thing about Spock later not going into command. It's like we never knew how Tribbles kind of came into being, and you could do it really poorly, which you'll probably say it's not the best way to do it, but I just thought it was, again, delightful that it's like this stupid story. I think this is like, you know what it is? This feels like live action Lower Decks, but like when it's a sweet episode.
I hope
like,
not.
You know what I mean? Like,
I hope not.
But that's what it feels like.
I hope
like.
That Lower Decks is much better
than this.
The tone,
I would say. I think it will be. Don't get me wrong. I think Lower Decks is going to be a hit. I'm looking forward to it. I just think that that's where these short tracks, these two in particular, they both have like a very lighthearted, tone that's kind of like more on the humor side, you know, like than on the serious side.
I just find that like, that's like the humor in The Trouble with Edward. I like that there's humor. I just find that the humor that they used doesn't relate very well to 23rd century. I think it feels more like what would happen in a 21st century environment. You know, the way the characters react, the way the characters interact, it feels very The Office or very like what we would do to each other. Not someone in the 23rd century.
That's
the way that
I think
the way that the captain and him have that back and forth, which was frankly too long. I get what they tried to do. The scene was just too long. They should have cut that down. It got real awkward to watch at some point. And she handled it pretty poorly as well, but I guess it's her first day as captain.
Well, I agree. I think they were both actually examples. What I liked about this short Trek is like we only see the best of the best in Star Trek when we're on a ship like the Voyager or on Deep Space Nine or on the Enterprise or on the Discovery even kind of. It's the first that I think kind of broke from that, right? That idea that everyone's so professional and so like perfect.
Well, technically like, not, the, because know, on like, Deep Space Nine it's not the best of the best and on Voyager it isn't either.
I think that they are among the best of the best. You're right. There are the characters have deeper flaws than in any other series in Deep Space Nine. But I think that like Discovery gives Deep Space Nine a run for its money as far as flawed characters are concerned, right? And I think that like here we're on a different ship completely. We're on this research vessel, and it is actually it's allegorical in a different way. Like here it shows us kind of like Star Trek has always kind of done this thing for me personally where it kind of gives you a model of how to behave or how not to behave to be successful. Like it just in general, you know,
Star Trek
in
is
any
a
kind
role
of
model, or at least it used
it's a
to
role
be,
model,
because
right.
Now it's not.
Well, no, I don't. I disagree. I think it's still a role model because it's showing you the thing is that like, I don't know about your, you know, society or your societal interactions immediately. Like, you know, I interacted with you. We have a very interesting interaction. Like some would say that we could be a Short Treks episode in and of ourselves, but you know, we have the excuse that we're all humans in the, you know, 21st century. Right. So we're all a bit flawed. We're not as advanced as the humans in the 23rd century. But what I will say is that, like, I kind of, like, am enjoying the fact to see things that are relatable that are not set on my beautiful Enterprise. Like, I do want to keep my Enterprise and my Voyager and my, you know, Deep Space Nine a little more perfect. Like, I want those, like, those bigger stories to be a little bit more of, like, what I aspire to be. So it's nice in this short treks to see, like, a failed crew. Like,
think,
this crew
I think,
doesn't work.
I think it's
like, and there's that scene with the Trill officer where the captain seems to actually be flirting, and I'm like, you know, this captain was kind of like a, like, in my mind she wasn't like, she's not Pike, right? Even though she like served under Pike, she's definitely not him. I can see how she's trying to be him, but she's definitely doing things that are like very rough around the edges, like a new captain making mistakes. And so yeah, she does make a mistake with Edward, but I think Edward is also a little bit too, I think Edward commits the greater wrong in my opinion in the episode. Like if there was someone who was more wrong, it was Edward, because he wrote, like, he thought he was writing anonymously, which I think is hilarious, because there's no such thing as anonymous now. Like why would there be an anonymity in the future, right? So he thought
he
was
signed it anonymous like an idiot, right?
Oh yeah, or something like that. But he probably sent it from his computer terminal,
his channels, right? Or his codes or whatever.
His codes or whatever, yeah. Like it's kind of weird, right? It's like, so he's obviously a weird person and he's not considerate, and then he insults her. He's like, so which one are you? Are you incompetent or are you dumb? Like, you know, it's like he's a mean person.
Okay, but here's the thing. If a child does something dumb and a parent reacts in a dumb way, is the child to blame, or is the parent kind of responsible of that situation because they're in command? You see what I mean? And this is kind of the same thing. He does a bad thing as an officer, but she's in a situation where she should have reacted better. She's the captain here. She should have reacted better. Anyway, it was regardless of whose fault it is, the interaction is weird and it shouldn't exist in Starfleet. And I feel like the people behind Discovery and the Short Treks currently are obsessed with making everything like Starfleet related. You could have made this story about people, even if you want to make them humans, you didn't have to make it Starfleet. You could have just made it a bunch of people on a planet. You know what I mean? Why do you have to always downgrade the quality of Starfleet and its officers to create your stories? You know what I mean?
There's this episode later on in TNG. I think we already did it. Did we do the episode where... yes, we did. I don't know if you were on that episode, but it's the episode where this, like... Geordi's dating this officer who was thought to be dead, and she's... Do you remember that one? Mm. She's actually, like... She's actually innocent, but she's awful. Like, she had this argument with this other... with her commander, and it was kind of a similar situation. I think it was just... the tone of it was just handled differently in TNG, but, like... it was another Starfleet... like, a research facility where it was just, like, a smaller crew, and, like, they didn't get along at all. And it's, like, we never saw that play out, which is, I think, what is cool about this episode, is that we actually see it play out. And for some people, that's, like, not interesting at all. And for other people, it's like, oh, good. But, like, I'm glad it's not set on the Enterprise. I'm glad that didn't happen on the Enterprise, because I don't think it would. Like, I feel like Captain Pike runs a pretty tight ship, you know? Like, I don't think it would have happened in on his ship. But the other thing is, like, I definitely would not like a show set on a research vessel. And I agree with you 100% that it would have been more interesting if this was on a completely different setting, in terms of, like, still in the Federation, but to show more diversity is actually what you're saying.
They
in the Federation to show, like,
they really do have,
yeah, to show, like, a different type of thing.
Sorry, they have an opportunity to do something, like, really, I don't know, go further with these Short Treks. They don't have to stay specific to Starfleet vessels and Starfleet officers, but they keep on coming back to that.
I think that, like, we should remember also that I think genuinely there's these Short Treks are kind of like a little tease or an answer to the big outcry of wanting a Pike and crew based Star Trek to be a reality. So
yes and no. I think this is I think this is a way of using the Enterprise sets that they built and trying to, like, not waste money.
Well, I mean, it's not about wasting money. It's about, like, maximizing your investment, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Because the money's been spent.
Didn't say it right. But I think that's mainly what's going on, is, like, we need to use these sets because we built them.
But what a delightful way to use them. And what sets are they reconstructing? I could tell in, like, in the end scene that it's, like, the transporter again. Like, they love to use the transporter room and restage it to be all kinds of other rooms. But, like, what was, like, the ship? I thought they did a good job, if they didn't build a brand new version of the Cabot. I thought they did a good job of showing making it feel like you were on a different ship completely than the Discovery.
They used some of the hallways, and they slapped new different designs on the walls or whatever it was. So there you got that little station where that science officer was working on, and the captain said good job and what have you. So that was like one of the Discovery hallways, I think, or one of maybe the Enterprise hallways. They had like a kind of like an office or a lab kind of strapped onto it.
Right. I also thought the lighting was gorgeous, like in the conference room scene. And I
and the CG was great.
That's what scares me, is I feel like the trailer, the most recent trailer for Picard, doesn't even have CG as good as what we saw
Feel like it will get better.
I don't think those are finished. Yeah, they're not finished.
I mentioned the Discovery Shuttle in the Picard trailer in my video, and I think that I really do believe that that's just, like, placeholder. They needed
not just that, though. It doesn't seem finished. Like, you know, like the what is the name of the ship? The Senorita? The
La Serena.
La Serena. La Serena. La Serena. Is it Serena?
Yeah.
Like Serenity? Like no. A nod to the show Serenity?
No, Serena. Serena as in Mermaid.
I mean, the movie? Oh, Mermaid. Oh, the Mermaid. Ooh. Jean-Luc is riding in the Mermaid.
Ooh, the Mermaid.
I love the mermaid. This is my new ship, the mermaid.
The mermaid.
Get out of my fucking way or I'll destroy you with my firepower. It is a cool... I like that they... Because it makes... We see it in Discovery Era, which is wrong. But I like that the way they power... You know, that they navigate is like... Air controls, basically. It's like they're not really there, right? It's like just stuff. He's just kind of like pulling on holograms, which is kind of an interesting concept.
It's a very Tony Stark thing. I'm not sold on that. I don't think it's a.
But it could fit with. It's the future. It's the Star Trek future.
I will never complain about it in Picard.
That respect,
because you'll just like aesthetically it works. It's on a personal level. I'm not that much of a fan of it. Neither am I in the Avengers, but like.
Right.
It works. It's coherent.
But you have to admit that was like a sentimental scene in Spider-Man Far From Home when he kind of modifies his suit.
Oh,
right?
The spoilers. Oh, dear Lord.
Oh, I forgot. Okay, coming back goodness. To this episode of Short Tracks.
I enjoyed the fact that they tied the end of the trouble with Edward into the Klingon Tribal War that we've heard so much about. So basically, the Klingons... have had like three major wars or whatever it is in their history. There's like the Federation Klingon War. There's what are they called? The Herc Klingon War, and then there's the Tribal Klingon War. And I love the idea of like one of their greatest enemies are the Tribbles. And it makes so much sense now. This Short Tracks, if anything, helps clarify that, because these Tribbles are replicating or are reproducing a lot more than what they did on any of the other like appearances that we've seen, and it does seem completely overwhelming. And I love the fact that this ship might have drifted into like Klingon space, fallen onto a planet. It creates a diplomatic incident because like all of the Klingons now have to defeat these Tribbles. They mobilize the entire fleet. They got everyone just fighting the Tribbles.
And it explains why Tribbles are afraid of Klingons, and because they've killed so many Tribbles. Like,
which would
like...
indicate something very scary. If 10, 20, 30 years from now, Tribbles are still afraid of Klingons. Clearly they're not the same Tribbles, right? It means that they are a higher memory. Species like us. And the other dude wanted to eat them.
Yes. Not only did he want to eat them, he fed them to the other guy. That was, come on, that whole scene was really funny because, like, would you eat a Tribble?
No. What was funny to me, I liked
the even if you were starving, would you, like, it's so gross.
I liked the humor in the beginning of the episode. That's the humor that worked the best for me was kind of like, what's your department doing? And he goes, I don't have a department. It's just me. I like that. He's got this kind of, like, I don't know, this cold kind of just straight up delivery. Like, I don't have a department.
He doesn't know how to work his thing. By the way, I love that I was trying to say this earlier. I love the try screen that's on the conference
they have that,
table.
They have that in Discovery.
But for some reason, this one feels like...
bitter.
Right. I quote a tweet. I don't know if you saw it, but I was just saying... I said... I twat a tweet. Oh, whoa, that's not good. Anyways, it's starting to feel more familiar to me in this, like, it's just something about the colored uniforms, and then I know they're still mixing the two era, like all the admirals were wearing the Discovery type uniform, like I don't even know what to call it, like just like that uniform, you know, it's like, and then, but I feel like the, you know, the yellow and the reds and the blues, seeing all that is like really familiar, and it just like, I know that that's not like, I'm not trying to say that it's like perfect or like that they've nailed it. I just think that like helps
close.
Me to kind of, yeah, it helps me to get
Discovery
into,
is
kind of
like a slow child, isn't it? It learns, but
what was that? Why would you even compare a show to a child with learning disability or learning differences, I guess I should say. I don't know what you're trying to, like, where did that come from?
Some children learn slower than
others.
I'm
a slow child. I was a slow child, by the way, just so you know.
But you got to where everyone else is, right? It just took you maybe a little longer, or like a different kind of learning. Basically.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
That's Discovery.
I'm Discovery. I'm the slow child.
Discovery is
me.
Discovery
You're
is
saying
le-
I'm
Discovery
Star Trek
is learning.
Discovery.
It's learning.
I'm learning.
But it's you know, you just gotta teach it a little different.
I know, I get you. I hear what you're trying. I wish you didn't pick on poor slow children like myself.
I don't pick on slow children. You very well know that I don't pick on slow children.
I don't know if I want to be compared to a show, but I get it. I'd rather be compared to like the Next Generation. I feel really like out of place now. But now I know
the Next Generation. No, like if it reassures you, I would compare no child to the Next Generation. Because it's just too good. Or maybe just that one gifted child, right?
That's what I was hoping you thought of slow child. No, I'm just kidding. That's what I like to be seen as the TNG child. But I'm not.
We're not. Well, we all want to be Riker, but we're all Barclay.
Some of us want to be Picard. And he will slow down in the Picard series. He won't be as fast as we're used to. there are things there are things like that are really interesting. What more what was this about the Klingon Tribal War? Where did that like pop in from? Like, where do we know that from?
I forget
from?
Where that came in. I think it's Worf that explains that. I think it's Worf
in
the Deep Space Nine crossover with the original series. I think
with Or is that really called a crossover because they weren't running at the same time?
No, it's
like a homage.
It's unique, honestly. Like no other shows I've never seen that. They're done. It's Star Trek is full of firsts and it's full of glorious, unique things. This is one of them.
This is one of them.
Believe it or not, the short treks as a concept is as well. I've never seen this kind of thing.
No, you've said actually you've said that on your. Quick plug for the audience that if you're still listening at this point, Trek on the Tube explains a lot of things that even I thought I knew a lot about Star Trek that I learn new things every time I watch your videos. So I highly recommend if you want to go deeper, deep into the wormhole. If you want to go deep into the wormhole, or if you're new to Star Trek, do you divide on your channel? Like, is there like Trek on the Tube for beginners, like Trek on the Tube news,
not so much.
Trek on the Tube advanced?
If you go onto the homepage of the channel, you find yourself like confronted with playlists. There's news, canon and lore.
It's an aggressive tone. You're confronted by it. You're not welcomed to Trek on the Tube. You're confronted by it.
You're not. All of your opinions are shambled.
Wow. Oh my goodness. We've been talking for way too long. Clearly, we've reached that point in the conversation.
It's too much. This is too much.
No, but seriously. But I have a little. I have a few more things about Edward.
Oh, I have playlists. Okay. I have races. I have canon and lore. I have the news. So it's all divided into little segments that, like, you can watch the, you know, races playlist and have nothing to do with the Discovery reviews if you're not interested.
Yes. And if you tuned into the last episode of Starfleet Boy, I was miffed that I was not your first Patreon person. I'm so bummed about that. But I am honored to be in good company with the people that did sign up so far. So I'm about to be your patron.
I thank you very much.
I thank you very much. As I stated before, you are the gift to this show. So thank you for coming on and indulging my love of all things Star Trek, whether you agree
your
or not.
9 out of 10 ratings for everything.
My 9 out of 10 ratings.
So you gave the first one a 9.5. This one you're gonna give it like a 12. How like the Picard, Children of Mars, the Picard tie-in one is probably gonna get like a 16 or something.
That was very passive aggressive. I think that we established that these are these are bundles. So
I don't
each
do
passive
aggressive. I just do aggressive.
Aggressive. It's true. Good. That was very aggressive. That was very aggressive. I think that in this bundle, this is a bundle, and that I think that the Children of Mars is going to be in a different bundle. What do you think about that?
No, it's literally part of the same freaking bundle.
No, there's this. You can. There's an argument that there's like a Pike bundle. There's a.
Those are sub bundles.
There's gonna be there's gonna be a Discovery bundle.
Those are
and then there will be a Picard bundle. We're gonna get a Picard and a Discovery bundle.
There's
up until
well, there's
now,
no Discovery
the short
ones,
tracks
technically.
Have,
the, well, these are Discovery
up
ones.
Up until they're now, Pike, they've all been... Right.
Discovery, Pike, kind of. Well, but there's going to be two animated yeah. ones.
Oh, that's right. Oh, my gosh. We haven't had, like, an animated Star Trek since when?
This...
Yes.
72 or 73 or 74, whatever.
So
it was.
Short Treks 70s. Will. Short Treks is actually the. Not the unofficial, the real official return of animation to Star Trek.
Yes.
And Lower Decks will be the next.
Yes.
The continuation of that.
The animated
wow.
series ran from 73 to 74.
Wow.
Mm.
Do we have any. Like, we're going to get a. I love, by the way, that all these Short Treks are coming out and kind of filling this, like. Hype gap between now and Picard. The hype gap is filled. The gap, the thirst gap. The thirst gap is
the
filled.
First
the thirst gap.
Gap. I don't know about that. I don't know. Where are you taking this?
I found out about the expression TFW. Do you know about TFW?
TFW? I don't know.
The feeling when.
Oh, okay. I thought it was like the fear of winning or something.
Wow. Or it could be the fear of women. I don't know. It could be a lot of things. But it's TFW, the feeling when. Or the feels when. Some people say the feels when.
The feels when.
And I got TFW at the beginning of this episode. Can we just talk about the beginning again? Can we show... Oh, I
no,
don't have the clip.
I don't think you're allowed to
I
do
can't
that.
I can show the clip. I'm going to show the clip. Damn yeah. it. Show the clip, Captain Number One. Show the clip.
I'm pretty sure you can't. I'm pretty sure you can't.
It's here. It's being played right as we speak. It's
right,
on your chest.
Well.
I've placed the clip on your chest.
Yeah.
There it is.
There's an
look,
Enterprise
look
here.
Everyone. By the way, what Enterprise is that? It's the film era.
This is the
Enterprise.
Correct Enterprise. It's the Enterprise A.
What does that mean?
I'm full of statements. No, this is the Enterprise that I prefer.
The correct... Yes.
You know, the Trekkie fandom is so insane, because someone actually commented that this font here is the original series font, but this Enterprise is the movie's Enterprise. And they're like, I don't understand. Your t-shirt doesn't work.
Can I tell you? Wait, that's Discovery in a nutshell, because you have the movie era alerts in the TOS era. It's like...
Don't get me started on
here
that.
You go.
On that bullshit.
Here you go, boy.
I love this Enterprise. This is the one.
Look at this. Here she is.
Fantastic. It makes no sense as a refit. To the original series Enterprise, I don't know. It's literally a new ship, but.
Do you know that the Enterprise A is my favorite Enterprise as well? Did you know that?
Did it? Okay, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's my favorite.
Well,
ask the doctor; he can vouch for me. It has been for the longest period of time too. The next favorite is the Sovereign class. I love the E, second, and then the D.
This time.
I think would be my third, and then the B. And then the C, and then the O1.
Enough with your list, sir.
My ranks. That's another podcast called
Enough
Trek Ranks, which I haven't heard too much about. But
I know about them, but I've never heard them. I think we should end this.
I think so, too, but we have to give our...
our ratings.
Wait, there was one thing I wanted to say, which was... wasn't this vessel in the Battle of the Binary Stars?
It probably was.
So, it's sad to imagine...
But not this vessel, specifically.
Oh, okay. When does this take place?
This is, who the hell knows? This could be before Discovery Season 1.
That's what I'm saying. So, could this...
This could be post-Discovery Season 2.
Wait. This vessel crash lands in this episode. I forgot about that. It structurally fails. You're right. But this style of vessel was in
the
battle.
It's the ship class.
The ship class. Very good, very good. That's the only other question I had, which I totally don't know why I got that wrong. It's clear in the episode that it crashes to the planet below and creates a triple crisis. Tying this into, creating an origin story for the Tribbles, I thought was great. I liked everything about it. My rating is a solid 10 for this episode.
Oh, poppycock.
I loved it. What mainly kind of got me, though, I have to say, is, you know, going back to that sentimentality that I think you have sentimentality. I have what is excessive sentimentality. And for me, my buttons were all pushed in just the best ways. Again, with Captain Pike, and my mom loved it too because she was like, "Oh, there he is, my boyfriend." So,
yeah. He's in like one scene.
It was great, though. I just want a whole... I just can't wait till the show, if we get a show. I don't know if we will get a show, but I hope we do. You're trying to figure out what number your rating is, average on the high side?
No, I'm no, it's a six.
Oh, a six, sorry. Yeah.
But I don't... I'm a bit like you, you see. This is the first time, but I'm going to say this. I might give ratings like average on the low side, average on the high side, but sometimes... For the sake of this show, you want a number. They might not necessarily match up. The sentiment might not necessarily fit the number. But in this case, it does.
It's a six.
It's a six. It's not bad.
I love
it's
it. Not.
I would have done a few things a bit different with the humor, with the comedy. But I love the... He makes a comment about how they have no face or something. At some point, like, they're not sad or whatever because they got no face. It's such a terrible thing to say.
So terrible. It's the worst. There's some really... That's what I liked about it is that, like, Edward is definitely, like, an undesirable type of character, but there's also things about him where you're like, I kind of understand. He's kind of like this person that we are sometimes... Every one of us has been Edward sometime. You know, like, at one point or another, we've been, like, an Edward, you know? So he's relatable in that way. Fortunately, I don't know anyone who's as
but
bad.
But I would like those characters to not be Starfleet officers. That's just me. I would like these
that's
relatable
not
characters.
Fair. What if he's the not... best? Look, clearly he's like he created like it's you know it's like Frankenstein's monster. But,
yeah, but
he
they don't
created,
redeem
like, a
him.
Scientific...
They don't redeem him or show his qualities.
Yeah,
like
you can't
like
do
they
it,
do with Barclay. They just kill him.
You can't. But he might have actually gone nuts. Like he might actually be at the end of his life, which is what we see of this in this short track, you know, like in an Edward prequel maybe we can find his humanity.
Is that
but
really
in,
necessary?
But maybe he's just gone completely nuts, you know, like he's gone I mean he was in the hallway in his underwear. What is that kind of behavior?
Why is that why is that in an episode of Star Trek?
Why is that? Well, if it was Chris Evans, like some people wouldn't mind. But I'm just saying, like.
Oh well, I mean, that would be like a.
I have a question for you. What? How would you feel about Edward if Chris Evans had played him? Do you think he would have changed the way the character was interpreted by people? Like, would he have been more desirable if he was handsome?
Absolutely
handsome.
You know what?
Yeah.
In Discovery Season 2, the Bowel look hideous, but if they were very cute little fuzzy beings, everyone would hate the Kelpians, because the Kelpians
yes.
did some very wrong things to the Bowel. But oh,
well,
the Bowel are mean and bad because they're black and gooey.
I thought they looked kind of cool, but they do look scary, you're right.
They are. They live in these big tube-like ships. I don't know why. They just chill inside some sort of goo.
that's the sound they make as they travel through the goo.
How am I supposed
the
to
Ba'ul,
know?
Could the Ba'ul be like a side type of species to the to Odo's race? Like
the
because
the metamorphs, the sludge folk,
the changeling. Slow. Are we back to the slow folk? Now it's a folk. It's a race of slow people. It's not just the slow.
You misunderstand.
Like
I said the sludge. I said the sludge folk.
Oh, sludge. I heard slow, and I was like, man, he's obsessed with the slowness. Like, what are you doing here? Are you casually and informally picking on me? It's like, what is going on?
Go on. No one's gonna watch all of this.
No one's gonna watch all this. Anyways, we're gonna end. We're going to end there. This was delightful. If nothing else, I had a darn good time talking to you today.
Well, I did
too. And it looks like, from the looks of the laughs, the TFW, it looks like you had a good time too.
No, I didn't.
Can we have... For, yes, you did.
Yes, I did.
For our audience, can we have a Picard update from what's going on in the world of Picard that you know of?
That I know of?
Yeah, what's the latest non-spoilery stuff for Picard?
Well, not much.
Like official stuff. Nothing.
We just got a trailer. If you want to watch the trailer, then watch it. But there are spoilers. It's coming on January 23rd, officially, which is earlier than what I thought. But some countries will get it January 24th. Simply because of the way that, you know, the world works and how we have different time zones. And
like New Zealand will get it on the 24th, right?
Oh, New Zealand will get it in friggin', you know, like December, whatever. Because they're just...
Wow.
No, it'll be 23rd.
I mean, you're part Kiwi, it's okay.
I am part Kiwi.
You can criticize your own. If anyone can.
There's nothing much to say about Picard at this point. It's just, I think that it's generating a lot of chat. There's a lot of these not Star Trek related YouTube channels that do top 10s or breakdowns or what you missed in the trailer kind of videos that are all completely dumb and wrong. But they all make them regarding, usually they do Star Wars or the MCU or Game of Thrones. And now they're doing that for Picard. They've never done this for Discovery. And they're doing this for Picard, which means it's generating mainstream attention. Which, even if the videos are shite and they say shite things, at least it's generating hype.
It's an indicator.
And it's creating discussion, and it's people are aware. So that's cool.
Well, this was a nice gift that I got, and I'm wearing it every day. I've been wearing it everywhere.
I'm so jealous. So,
with that Patreon money, you can go and get one. I authorize you to use my Patreon money to get yourself.
No, that's not the objective. The objective is to save up the money.
I know, but I authorize
and get a camera.
I'm your patron. Damn it! Don't argue with your patrons. You realize you're giving me control into your life. Depending
on
my level, my tier. I am a shareholder. I want you to get a Picard. No, I like your original shirts, and I can't wait to buy the one that you're gonna make. That I suggested.
I ordered a few sample ones, so I might be wearing some Trick on the Tube shirts now in my upcoming videos.
Are you planning to? As you can see, I'm a hoodie person. Are you planning to make a Trek on the Tube hoodie?
Well, all of the shirt designs are available in hoodies.
I didn't know that.
Mm. There you go.
I wasn't paying attention.
Well, it says shirts on the website, but once you click on the actual like design that you desire, it asks you what kind of like shirt you want. If you want a woman's shirt or a men's shirt, but there's also the hoodie option. So you can get a hoodie. You can get any kind of color.
I can't wait.
You can get a goddammit Bob hoodie.
There's a goddammit Bob?
Yes.
Yes. Oh my gosh, I clearly didn't look. I thought I looked. I thought I was looking at everything, but I wasn't. Bad boy.
I did a Picard shirt as well, which I find funny.
Let's go there now. It's on trekonthetube.com.
No, that doesn't exist.
What?
Trekonthetube.com is not a thing.
Oh, hold on. We have to end. Did we officially end the show?
I don't know.
No, let's end it right now.
All
right. Hold on. Because we're getting into... I can't show the screen anymore. I can't show people what we're... Ever since Google Hangouts, like, I can't actually show them. Mm, so I'm just going to look for myself. By the way, I have something to plug.
Okay, well, go ahead. Plug it, and then we'll get lost.
There's a new episode of Drunk Space Nine coming out, dropping today. Cool. So there's three Starfleet Boy. Starfleet Boy! That's how you officially how you say it, by the way. Do you know that?
Oh,
right?
Is that the canon way of saying it?
Stuffy boy. Can you try it?
Stuffy boy.
Yes. Nice.
So that's the shirt, Starfleet, and then just boy.
Boy. You can also extend it like Stuffy boy.
It's got like a million eyes that just go onto the sleeve.
My autobiography is going to be called My Boy Starfleet.
My Boy Starfleet, oh yeah.
My Boy Starfleet.
Wouldn't it be like Star Trek and Me?
That's a good title too. Anyways, thank you for joining us, audience. We really enjoyed having you.
Please
leave your questions, comments, judgments, everything down below in the comment section. And I hope you live long and prosper, and we'll see you next time.
Well, they better live long and prosper.
Oh. I'm going to stop. I'm stopping all this nonsense right now.